Now, that is what our panel is going to discuss today in this session. This is going to be an interesting discussion on driving deep user engagement within your app. Now, let's have a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, a virtual one rather, while we welcome our session chair for the panel discussion, Mr. Naveen Madhavan, Vice President of Growth Platforms at InMobi, helps performance marketers globally drive growth for their apps and achieve their advertising goals by leveraging the digital medium, especially mobile. Now, may I request Mr. Naveen Madhavan to take over and introduce our panelists. Very warm welcome to you, firstly.
Thank you, Kathy. Good evening to everyone. I would hope and assume it's a full room, like it's a virtual event, so I no longer have to look out for a packed room. I know that given the panel that we have lined up for today, it's definitely going to be like an interesting one, and there's going to be a lot of insights coming up in the next 30 to 45 minutes. So I will start off by calling upon the stage to join some of my panelists. First up, Sunil Suresh, who is the CMO of Make My Trip Group.
Hi, everyone.
Welcome, Sunil. Next, I have Pratik Mukherjee, who's the Director of Marketing at Urban Company.
Hey, hi, everyone.
Welcome, Pratik. Last, but definitely not the least, Aishwarya Murli, Head of Marketing at Ola.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Aishwarya. So I think before we jump into the topic, I think it makes sense, even though people may know us, I think it's just good to give ourselves a quick introductions in terms of what we do, our background, so that hopefully it helps the audience form an understanding of the context from where we are sharing some of these insights as well. So firstly, I'll go first. As Kathy mentioned, I work at InMobi. I've been at InMobi for over 7 years. So yeah, I think the mobile ads and the mobile ads that many of you hate seeing continuously come up on your apps, InMobi has had some role to play in it. We do try and make sure they're interesting. In my current role, I work with app developers on the marketing and advertising side. In my 7 years or so at InMobi, I worked on monetization and advertising, and I've had the pleasure of working with many of the large brands from India and globally. So it's great to be on a panel with some of our partners and also see what insights they share and what is it that they really do to drive user engagement on their apps. So I'll request my fellow panelists also to do a brief introduction. Aishwarya, if I could request that you go first.
Hi, I'm Aishwarya. I head marketing for Ola. I've been here for about a year and a half, and it's been an exciting ride so far. I worked with Furlenco earlier for about 3 years, and I looked after their growth and revenue and marketing. And before that, I was with Unilever for about 11 years, and that's pretty much how I started my career. So that's just a little bit about me.
Thanks, Aishwarya. Next up, Pratik, if you could go.
Hey, hi, everyone. Pratik, super excited to be part of this virtual workshop, still getting used to the rules of the game when it comes to virtually interacting with a lot of you out there. Been with Urban Company now for close to 2 years. I am a director of marketing here. Before that, like many of us, I also started my career at Procter & Gamble FMCG industry, spent close to 7 years there. And super excited to be part of this discussion with all of you on a topic very close to my heart. I truly believe that app or our mobile phone is the core to the brand that we are building. All the companies, be it Make My Trip, be it Urban Company, Ola, I think gone are the days when brand building was about top of the funnel marketing and spray and pray, as a lot of us call it. It's the real estate is the brand, the product, the app that we all sort of work on. So truly passionately looking forward to this conversation.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Sunil. I lead marketing for the Make My Trip group. So I don't know how many of you know, we've basically got three brands in our stable. So we've got Make My Trip, we've got GoIBibo, and we've got Redbus. I began my career as well at Unilever. So I was there at Unilever for quite a long time. It's got to a stage where I don't like talking about how many years I've been working at each place, because it gets me to a place that I don't want to be at, but I spent several years at Unilever, then moved to Dubai. So actually, again, moved to Yum Brands in Dubai. So very different business context, was there for quite a few years. Then joined a startup called Capillary Tech, where I was there for a couple of years. Very interesting sort of stint, very different context, B2B, but again, you know, consumer tech. And I've been at Make My Trip now for a little over a year now.
Thanks, Sunil, Aishwarya, Prateek. You know, it's very interesting to see all three of you. When you talk about your journeys, all of you started from, like, you know, the biggest famed FMCG brands. And all of you lead marketing at apps, which are now become, like, you know, the newest brands appealing to the masses of India. I think it just talks about how far apps have come in their own journey and relevance and significance to the Indian population at large, right? It's just great to see marketers from different backgrounds coming in and bringing this. Me personally, I have not worked at an FMCG company, just to sort of set the context. Before I got into apps, I was in the world of investment banking, and I just sort of happened to stumble upon this, and it's been a fascinating ride for the last 7 years, right? So yeah, I think the topic on hand is definitely something very close to everyone's heart. Like, you know, everyone talks about user acquisition, everyone talks about, like, you know, driving marketing campaigns, how do we do brand recall? But I think in the context of mobile apps, really what matters is, once you acquire a user, how do you ensure you're able to actually drive deep user engagement on your app to make sure that whatever cost that you may have put in acquiring that user is repaid leaps and bounds with more time that they spend on your app, right? So I think I have a few questions lined up, and hopefully everyone will have enough insights to sort of jump into. I'm sure there is. And time permitting, we'll open up for audience question as well. So I think before we jump into, like, you know, the deeper context of, like, the nuances and the everything that's involved in how each of you make this extremely successful engagement on your user engagement work on your app, I think let's first lay down the ground rules, right? What does user engagement and retention really mean for each of you on your apps? What are the key metrics that you really track on an ongoing basis to see whether you are actually able to attract and engage users on a continuous basis? Sunil, if I could request that you start off on this question, and let Prateek and Aishwarya chip in later.
Sure. So, you know, when we look at user engagement, retention, et cetera, there are a few macro level metrics that we look at, you know, things like repeat rate, monthly visits per user, and so on and so forth. But what we figured is, you know, looking at it at a macro level can be very, very misleading. And, you know, therefore, I think the metrics that the team typically works on are metrics that are very, very segmented. So, you know, we operate on a very sort of customer segment level, and we have different metrics that we look at depending on the segment characteristic, right? So you'd look at, you know, for instance, things like transactions per user, visits per user, you know, what we call lob depth, or really the, you know, the line of businesses, how many different lines of businesses has the user actually transacted with. So you look at things like lobs per user and so on and so forth. And typically, you know, as we think about users, and, you know, what we found is highly engaged users do tend to transact a lot more, typically as much as 30 to 50% more. So we do look at both of these metrics, right? So one is to look at, you know, what is the frequency of transaction, but equally, what is the frequency of visits? And, you know, obviously we work through different sort of reasons as to why the consumer would come back to us. But yeah, so not a simple answer. I think it's not like there's a clean metric that we look at. I think there's a, you know, a lot of sort of segmentation that goes into this.
Personal. I think, yeah, it is a complex world, and it takes some time for all of us to get there.
I'll just add to what Sunil was building. So obviously there are standard metrics like, you know, repeat rate. A lot of time at our end goes in doing a detailed drop-off analysis for all the sessions that the users create. We spend a lot of time in understanding the entire funnel as to why a user is dropping off at a cart page, at a scheduler page, at a booking page. And also then engaging with those consumer samples to figure out if there is a common issue or a common pattern at play. You know, post-COVID being a great example, and maybe we'll talk about it in some time. So a lot of time is spent in understanding drop-offs in a lot of detail and how to sort of then reactivate them. The other piece, probably very important at Urban Company, given the gamut of services we have, be it beauty, be it homes, we have a service like Salon at Home for Women, which is a very regular service, like a 30 to 45 day frequency service. On the other extreme end, there is a home painting, which people typically would get a retouch done maybe 3 years, 4 years, if not more. So that's the gamut of services I'm talking. So very, very important for us to do a good job of cross activation across categories. And over a period of time, the team tries to establish those baselines that what's the right second crossover category for a female consumer who, let's say, gets acquired by a salon at home service. Should the second service be cleaning at home? Should it be spa? Should it be something more experiential, and so on and so forth? So again, it's a very, very complex combination of, I would say, science and art. I come from the school of thought where it's not just about plotting the cohorts on a piece of Excel, but also to understand the human beings who sit in those cohorts. And it's a combination of the two, which helps us reactivate people and also sort of manage the entire cross-category ecosystem.
Yeah, definitely. I don't think it's just about math and numbers, right? The psychology and understanding the users behind each of these cohorts matter a lot. How have you seen it working for you, Aishwarya at Ola? Like, what are the things that you observe?
Yeah, so it's pretty much some of the usual suspects, but each of them have a slightly more nuanced, sort of level to it, right? I think the first of engagement is the two big ones is one: are you getting number of rides that your user is taking? So if you were taking only 3 rides a month, is your user starting to take 4, 5, 6 rides, right? That automatically means that you're sort of jumping up the consideration set when it's coming to sort of ride hail, right? That's the first one. The second is, are they taking you for longer distances? So are you a short distance player or are you a long distance game, right? So are they taking you for longer distances, right? Which then shows again that there is a deeper engagement that's coming in. That is, of course, the two basic, like we call it, the output matrices, right? But if you look at a little further into the input matrices of it, right? Ultimately, like Prateek said, there are cohorts, right? So, and these cohorts are, we can say that they are people who take 5 rides a month, but typically you'll also find that use cases play a big role. Typically, if people are convinced onto you, they will use you for more frequent use cases. So for example, going to work, erstwhile going to work, and all of that. So, and everything that requires a more predictability in their routine, so they would use you. So you automatically know that you're winning the game over there if they're using you for your, frequent use cases. Whereas if you're just the choice of a Saturday night party or a coming back, you do know that you're an occasional use case, right? So then you sort of want to build yours back. So we have the heuristics can also tell you whether you're taking rides on the weekday, how frequent is it? Are you taking it on Saturdays and Sundays, which means it's a occasional use case, right? Even there, is it classes, evening, morning, all of those things. So I think for us, I think it also helps for us to get people into our frequent use cases cohorts. That's really the big joy for us because that really means a stream of revenue from a single user and the right usage, right? Because they trust you, they rely on you, so they come to you in some sense. The other thing that's interesting is, like Prateek said, the funnels, right? You automatically see your funnels improving when you're sort of giving the right experience at the bottom of your funnel, which is the right experience, etc. You also see it improving when you're giving the right messaging on the top of funnel as well, right? So things like they would install your app, but they may not take a ride with you. Why are they dropping off? Those kinds of things also sort of play into building the engagement piece. So I think that's a combination of what sort of we would look at. The output metrics, which are, the actual rides per user, and the input metrics of what kind of user, who is this person? Is he using me because he relies on me, or is he using me because, it's just one of those off cases that I want to use kind of thing. So I think that's the way we look at it.
Yeah, I think fascinating insights shared by all three of you, right? I think what's also coming out is that each line of business and use case needs to be looked at differently. Like, you know, understanding each of the three businesses that you spoke about have multiple line of businesses inside your own groups, right? Like, you know, some could be long distance travel, some could be just a hotel booking business versus personal travel, weekend versus weekday travel, occasional use case versus frequent use cases. So I'm sure each of you also, like, even in terms of your own decision making, the user cohorts have to be built out to sort of speak to that, right? I think just moving on to, of course, like, you know, what's a very interesting topic, because I think even in terms of the composition of the panel, the pandemic affected things differently for all three of you, right? So just to sort of help us understand, like, what exactly changed in terms of the rules for you pre and post pandemic, right? I think more importantly, I think some categories may have become irrelevant, or, like, you know, at least in the notion of people's consideration, they suddenly wiped out from becoming a daily use case to a very occasional or almost a never use case, right? I mean, I think just to, like, Ola and MakeMyTrip honestly fell into that category, and it would have definitely been a challenge, right? Whereas Urban Company on the other side would have been something which people started considering more, and there are many such instances. So how did each of you try and tackle this? What kind of activities did you do? What kind of metric changes did you start observing in terms of actually doing this? I'll go to the ones who had, like, a tougher life first before we go to the easier ones. So Aishwarya, why don't you take this first?
Sure. So I think, it was interesting. You know, I think it just got wiped out within a matter of weeks. Use cases that were everyday sort of disappeared off the radar. And I think that's what happened on travel and transport, and specifically to ride hail as well. So I think in these times, I think this was a time when you had to put your head down and actually do the right things, right? So if you start off right from the beginning, right, when there was absolute lockdown, the first thing that Ola did was partner with all the governments to ensure that emergency services we had cabs for, right? So so there were still needs to go to hospitals, there were still needs to go to medical facilities and so on and so forth. So that was the first sort of agility where we, you know, we sort of pivoted into sort of doing that. So we partnered with almost all of the governments to sort of be the emergency service provider, right? This worked with both patients as well as doctors, because even doctors needed to get to hospitals and back. The second was the whole aspect of you realize that, you know, we all have the luxury of working from home, but our drivers kind of don't, right? They really sort of rely on us for their livelihood. So that was when I think we sort of took that initiative, and irrespective of whether it, you know, if it was a ride-hail driver, we sort of gave them certain benefits across the board to help out during that 2 or 3 months' time. And we crowdsourced some of the benefits as well. So we had the driver fund, because they are the ones who drive us. Millions of drivers are actually not working from home, right? Because they just can't work from home. So that was another initiative where we sort of got drivers back on their, because the minute they want to come back, they should be able to come back, right? That's the idea. So that was the second big thing that sort of, you know, was agility. We realized we needed to do that for the driver is very much a part of the brand, right? As the driver is actually the flip of the brand. You know, consumer brand and the driver brand come hand in hand in any service. And I'm sure Prateek would agree with me in Urban Company as well. So I think that was super critical. I think the third way in which we sort of started, we realized as and when use cases opened up and people were comfortable with going out, as a human insight, you can never tell them start going out. All you can tell them is, and this was at phase two of the pandemic, right? You cannot tell them start going out. What you can tell them is, look, if you ever decide to go out for whatever reason you are comfortable with, you know, we are here for you to provide the safest option that you have. So that's when we sort of did the safe like home campaign, which is my safest ride, where it was more, and we took there was an operations effort, which was the biggest one. I mean, what marketing did was really quintessentially the icing on the cake, right? But the operations piece was the more rigorous one, where we sort of put protective screens between cars and drivers. We had a protocol of selfie authorization where, you know, if he wasn't wearing a mask, no mask, no ride. Consumer wasn't wearing a mask, no ride. Cleaning all surfaces, high touch surfaces in the car before you got in. So what we really told our customers is, look, you may want to go out, you may not want to go out. Each of you have different comfort levels. But look, if you do want to go out, here are all the precautions we're taking, right? I think that was phase two of the campaign. And more recently, I think when lockdown sort of started opening out and people are now sort of moving and things are back to normal, I think what we're telling them is do restart responsibly. That's really the way we are sort of talking about it. So that's how we had to pivot our user engagement through the pandemic. So it's like pretty much a 3 or 4 stage process that we've seen till now. And of course, I'm sure there are more processes and more stages to come as we battle it. But this is what it is till date.
Yeah, very interesting, actually. I think, like you said, often what we do or what marketing ends up doing is the final leg of the piece, right? But I think what's great is to remain nimble and make sure that you're talking to the consumers in the right fashion. Sunil, how about you and the Make My Trip group? Like, I'm sure a lot changed, but what were your reactions in terms of how you actually went about dealing with this?
Yeah, so I think, you know, as the sort of pandemic began, the one of the good things that happened, you know, is because we also sort of, you know, have close collaboration with C-Trip that's based out of China, I think we had a lot of conversations with them and, you know, they were ahead of the curve in a sense, you know, in terms of the pandemic and the impact and all of that. So, you know, I think we took a lot of learnings from there and we were able to actually, I think the first priority really was to go conservative and, you know, sort of conserve resources. So even before the lockdown, I think we'd got into the mode of, you know, sort of very quickly ramping down marketing. So we, you know, sort of whatever we could sort of cut back, I think we cut back and, you know, got into this conserve mode. Lockdown came and effectively, I think business went from whatever it was to zero overnight, given that, you know, no travel was possible. Early on, you know, while we did sort of partner with governments and, you know, we had a lot of sort of quarantine hotels and things that we partnered with, we had programs we called, you know, Stays for Saviors and so on and so forth. From a consumer standpoint, I think that early phase was really about empathy. So, you know, all our communication was really about stay indoors, you know, and there were some interesting campaigns we ran on multiple brands. And at that time, we thought through and said, you know, what should our overall approach be? And end of the day, it's really about, you know, how do you stay relevant to the consumer? And, you know, we sort of put together this multi-phase approach. We said, you know, there's no predicting how this pandemic's going to play out. But what we do know is there will be stages of the pandemic, right? So there will be sort of this early phase where, you know, no travel's possible. And there are a lot of customer service issues. And for us, you know, that was a huge priority because, you know, obviously everybody's travel plans got disrupted. There were lots of cancellations and people wanting, you know, refunds and so on and so forth. So that was sort of the early phase. We then said, you know, once the lockdown lifts, whenever that may be, you know, how do you sort of support people who have essential travel? Because clearly, you know, it's not like the pandemic is going to disappear, but you know, some people are going to want to travel. At that time, safety is going to be super important. So again, you know, we did a lot of work sort of thinking through how do we reassure customers on safety. And, you know, there was this program called My Safety and Go Safe, etc., that we launched, which is really reassuring customers on safe practices and, you know, looking at sort of the broader ecosystem. Because at the end of the day, you know, for us, the experience is really through all of our partners. So, you know, that was sort of the next phase. At this point, we also did a cross-industry, you know, sort of marketing initiative. It was really the safety pledge where we had, you know, over 30 CEOs of different travel companies coming together and reassuring customers that, you know, we do everything to stay safe and so on and so forth. And then from there on, I think it's really about, you know, gradual opening up. I think the good thing is that over the past few months, the momentum has been building up. And we have been sort of cautiously executing campaigns. So that's, you know, from a marketing campaign perspective, I think coming back to your original question on engagement and, you know, how has that changed? So if I look at what we used to do earlier and we talked about it, right, which was, you know, looking at repeat rate and so on and so forth, I think right now we are looking at it quite differently. So one of the things we did is we said, let's freeze as of end of March, right? Let's freeze our customer base and let's freeze the segments and the behavior and everything as of end of March, because people are obviously going to behave extremely differently through this period. And right now we're saying, okay, now we've got this nMarch base. How do you do two things, right? The first thing is, how do you reactivate this base? And that sort of is goal number one, where you're looking at the different sort of segments and, you know, setting goals of saying, how do you reactivate in terms of driving unique visitors? And then how do you convert those unique visits into transactions? The second goal is, once you've sort of reactivated this cohort, how do you then drive repeat? And, you know, sort of redefine what those metrics of repeat should look like. And, you know, that's where I think a lot of the, as they say, the devil is in the details, because, you know, just to give you an example, if you look at the macro numbers, right, you look at the macro repeat rate numbers, we actually find that the repeat rate numbers that we had pre-pandemic are very similar to what we have today. But when you actually dive deeper, you realize that the reason it's like that is because of the profile of travelers. So, you know, effectively what's happened is, people who were extremely frequent travelers pre-pandemic are traveling at maybe one third the frequency, but because, you know, they were so frequent earlier, at an average level, it actually looks very, very similar pre and post. So, you know, just to illustrate the importance of going into details as you're sort of working through some of this.
No, that's a very great insight, Sunil. I think, like, you know, obviously, I think details and crunching down to the most important numbers, going down to see where it matters, is actually quite interesting. And I think what you said in terms of just looking at a high level metric and being happy with it versus going down and analyzing what lies behind it is actually a great lesson for all of us, right? Yeah, I think one thing's remained consistent with both of you in terms of some the way in which you've went out with your marketing campaigns and communication. I think it's interesting to see, Prateek, what was the experience at Urban Company? I mean, at least my assumption was that after the first few months, one of the services that like people started discovering and using a lot more, with especially long hair and, like, you know, tough places to go to and just being comfortable in the space of your own home, Urban Company was at least one, like, you know, one group of logos that I started seeing around my locality a lot. What is it like for you in terms of, like, you know, the app, the experience, and the customer feedback?
Yeah, I think contrary to popular belief, the journey for Urban Company has also been one hell of a ride. We had to redefine each and every service, very similar to the Ola journey that Aishwarya was describing. For us, the first step was to protect all our partners, the close to 30,000 partners that work across 18 plus cities for Urban Company. When the pandemic hit, our first responsibility or port of call was to ensure that financially, from a loan point of view, because like some of you already said, we are the privileged you know, folks amidst all this. However, the, you know, they took a real hit. So first port of call was, how do we protect our partners and therefore their families and livelihoods? Till things started to open up around June, you know, after the lockdowns were lifted, societies were okay to let essential services enter your houses or societies. The second thing was, all of you who have may have taken UC services in the past, one of the differences is, we enter your house, and the kind of services that we deliver, we spend 2 hours, maybe 3 hours. In case of a full home cleaning service, it takes a whole day inside your house. And in the current environment pertaining to social distancing, people are like, I haven't met my parents for like since pandemic. So even if push comes to shove, earning the trust of consumers to let you in and deliver a 2 hour job, be it a home cleaning, be it a haircut, like Naveen, you mentioned, and so on and so forth, it required us to reinvent our core service offerings. Introduction of PPE kit, temperature checks. We introduced a ritual called Suraksha Namaskar. So whenever a partner would reach your doorstep, they would do a three-step Suraksha Namaskar. And it's also a check the consumer can do to sort of verify whether he or she wants that partner to enter the house or not. And the consumer reserves complete right to deny permission if he feels she's feeling sick or has any kind of symptom, et cetera, et cetera. So the harder work was to get our core offerings right, redo every service. And the devil here lied in the detail. For women, let's say, for example, threading is a very, very core salon service, using that as an example here. It's a service where the partner will come in very close proximity to you, forget the 6 feet norm. And therefore, we had to completely change the technique of some of these services to ensure that these services can be rendered even while maintaining the government protocols on social distancing. And of course, this was wrapped with a strong marketing campaign. Again, very similar to what Sunil and Aishwarya were mentioning. We call it UC Safe. But the core of the reinvention, coming back to user engagement, was building trust. I think this was the time the company realized that building trust via more ratings and reviews, allaying any concern when it comes to the safety protocol our partners would follow in form of stories in the app, in form of user testimonials. A lot of content had to be created overnight. These were all UGCs, user-generated content of early adopters of the post-pandemic services to allay concerns of other consumers. There were a lot of young mothers who obviously had no other option but to take UC Salon at home. So hearing from young mothers that how safe the service was, the fact that they could take the service even with a kid at home or with an elderly person at home, that helped a lot in what I call winning back trust, social proofing, which has come a long way. I mean, to put things into perspective, our conversion had completely tanked post-pandemic when we resumed services in June. But if I look at my current numbers, our conversion is back to pre-pandemic levels, which gives a good indication that the friction points have been addressed, the drop-offs have been taken care of via the right content on the app. Second piece is a major pivot to a metric I would call as reactivation. For a large number of services, say salon at home for women or home cleaning, because you are not stepping out, there is no need to groom or look good because you're not, the number of social occasions have gone down. So, I mean, Naveen, yes, completely agree to your point on the need for a haircut, but why do you need a haircut if you have to show up in a few meetings over a Zoom call and you have the option to keep your camera off as well, right? So the number of occasions for grooming has gone down to a point where, similar to what Aishwarya was saying, we can't force people to take the services, or it's not about pushing an offer or doing a sale event, but it is to tell them that, hey, whenever you need the service, be it for a Karwa Chauth, be it for a Diwali, which just went by, or be it for your office reopening, we are there. We are the safest option. And, we take care of the 7-step safety protocol that needs to be taken care of. So, yeah, it has been a reinvention of sorts when it comes to our core service journey, the entire app flow. The app you see now across services versus the app you would have seen, the version of the app you would have seen last year, is a completely different animal altogether. Some of the services have done really well. Professional cleaning, that's the need of the hour. Because you're spending so much time at home, you would probably want your bathroom, your kitchen, your entire house to be better cleaned because of the fact that 4-5 people are living under the same roof, using it as work and office both, right? So so that's one that has picked up. Men's grooming has done really well. But some of the other services, we are still fighting hard. Bounce back is on the way. Obviously, the last month was great due to the number of festivals in the country. The festive period, in fact, just got over as of Sunday. So, yeah, but it's been a one hell of a ride for us as well.
Yeah, I think, thanks, everyone. I think the pandemic was definitely like a shock which came into our lives, but everyone had to reinvent the way we lived, the way we worked. I think the one thing that stood out for me, at least, the way in which all three of you articulated what changed is, I think the first reaction was, of course, that of building trust and getting the empathy with not just customers, but partners as well. And making sure that the brand is there available for them when required in an opt-in basis and not try to be in their face when there are bigger problems for them in the world, right? Like you have your loved ones to worry about, you have so many things happening for you, all that you can do is be available when asked for. And I think the other thing, at least in terms of the actual tactics of marketing, is reactivation. Relying on the fact that you had brand loyalists at some point who you can touch back with and like actually tell them that when you come back on the app, we are putting out upfront what are the different things that we've done. And I think all three of you spoke about how the app went through a different set of planning to make sure that you earned that trust and telling them that it's a good time to be back and start consuming the services. So I think that's a great takeaway for anyone listening that, there will be challenges, but reinvention will always help us land to the right place, right? Yeah, I think The next question I have is more on the lines of, like, you know, being someone who works with marketers a lot, just always keen to pick the brain of marketers to understand, like, how you track back some of this, right? Like, all of you at different points in time have invested in, like, you know, large scale, like, you know, the conventional brand campaigns, brand marketing campaigns, which are going on TV, print, hoardings, everywhere, like, you know, to get to the masses. So what kind of mechanisms do you use to actually, like, tie back the effectiveness of these campaigns to back into measuring engagement or retention on your app? Like, you know, what is it that you've seen has worked for you? Prateek, if I could request that you go for this one.
Yeah, so I think what I would like to say here is it's very important to be very clear on the objective of the campaign and the channel being used each and every time. For example, there would be pure play sale campaigns, iconic sale campaigns, all the players, all the apps that we use have them. There will be brand building campaigns, or there could be a mix of the two, broadly speaking. And there, very, very sharp understanding of which channel should play what kind of a role. For example, in all my experience here, the role of television is more has been long-term brand building and salience marketing. The objective has been more around reaching your consumers at a defined frequency for obviously the cities that we are present in, which may require us to be laser sharp. And sometimes we have taken calls of only doing high definition TV and not standard definition TV to take control, to take care of the spillage that could happen. In terms of how such campaigns are measured, those are measured obviously via long-term brand health tracks, where you measure how your relevance for the service has gone up, how your consideration for at-home salon has gone up, and so on and so forth. And obviously the direct revenue and trial metrics are there for everyone to see. But coming back to your question, very, very important to get the role of each touch point over historical trend analysis, competitor analysis, seeing how your last campaign has performed. That for me is the most important piece. So of course, there are very, very basic pre versus post or test versus control methods to attribute how much incrementality a television campaign got us in X geography versus Y, where you didn't run the campaign. But larger or the broader learning has been that some of the mass media touch points, television plus, they have played a better role in long-term brand building, trust building, while, of course, there are day-to-day performance marketing campaigns, and then there are digital brand campaigns, which go a long role in immediate traffic uplift onto our platforms for the periods that we want to, or for the peak consumption points in the calendar, like the recent festivals being a very, very big peak for Urban Company because of the nature of services we are into. Then tracking the traffic uplift, obviously conversion improvement, and so on and so forth. And what I have also realized, coming back to the earlier discussion we were having, most of the campaigns, it's also important to be clear, what are we doing it for? Is it for new user acquisition, or is it for repeat resurrection? Some of our properties, we have a sale property called the Salon Spree. We have been running it for the last 3 years, and every year we run 3 to 4 editions of it. It's a great event which a lot of our loyal users look forward to. So whenever Salon Spree happens, our first port of call is to reach out to our dormant, churned, and active user cohorts, tell them about the offers and why they should take the service over the next 14 days of the sale. While there are some larger events we do, like Freedom Sale or Republic Sale, where the objective is to also do mass new user acquisition, talking to non-users. What it means, the communication is very different. The way you would talk to the repeat user base is very, very personal, very different. You know them better than the non-users, and therefore you can tailor your communication. Whereas when it comes to non-user, I would rely more on the mass media, television, print-led marketing, and reaching out to them with a broader value proposition, because I don't know that consumer that well. I think there is no straight answer here, but coming back, understanding the role of each channel, each event or each marketing campaign, and then defining KPIs according to the business requirement. I think that has been the mantra as far as I'm concerned.
Got it. Thanks, Prateek. How's it been for you, Aishwarya? Like similar observations, or have you seen, like, you know, do you also have clear distinctions of brand and performance, or do you run hybrid campaigns? So what have been your observations?
So I think it's, I echo a lot of things that Prateek said. So I think I'll not repeat a lot of things he said, because a lot of things are extremely similar in the way we look at it as well. I think first of all, if I have to divide the campaign types, you have acquisition campaigns and you have, re-engagement campaigns, right? Like how Prateek said. So you'd look to acquire a new user, or you would look to re-engage an existing user who has lapsed out of your platform, you know, either recently lapsed out or lapsed out long ago. Your strategy would be different, you know, depending on, you know, the kind of or the duration of the lapsing. I think broadly, if you have divided into two, the brand campaign is an umbrella thing. It subsumes everything. It is more about building consumer mind measures like top of mind, spontaneous recall, awareness, or specific mind measures you want to. Like, for example, if you want to be known as a safe service, you'll measure whether you're sort of achieving that with the campaign, etc. So mind measures are really how we look to measure anything on brand campaign, right? Of course, I think the business angle of a brand campaign will eventually boil down to a higher baseline shift on your organic visitors, right? Because people are fundamentally believing in you. So organically, more people are coming onto your storefront and transacting with you and taking rides. So your organic, the way we look at it is our organic baselines have to shift out, right? And that's really a shift that happens for the long run. So while you run the brand campaign, maybe your organic baseline shifts. And after you run the campaign, it dips down a little, but where it dips down is at a higher level than where you started off anyways in the first place, right? So that's how we measure the business angle of brand campaigns. But more importantly for brand campaigns, it's more about lifting the mind measures of consumers that we can measure independently through brand tracks and so on and so forth, right? So that's so much as far as brand campaigns are concerned. And of course, you know, in brand campaigns, even testing your creative through either Google, Facebook, they all have fantastic tools to test it, to see whether your cut-through message cut-through is, et cetera, happening well, is par for the course, but that's an input metric into the whole thing. I'm talking about how you look at the output measurement. Performance is a whole different ballgame altogether. It's pretty much a users and CAC game, right? So it's really about, I think Naveen, you would know that more than anything else.
Yeah.
So it's just it's just an input and output game. So you turn it on, you get the reusers, you get at a particular CAC, you turn it off, it goes away in some sense. And to that effect, I think you have a lot of sweeteners like offers or, like Prateek said, the whole Salon Spree, Flipkart's Big Billion, whatever those properties that you've created to sort of get the user and CAC ratio bettering that user CAC ratio as much as you possibly can. Of course, CAC is also measured on an LTV front, right? So whether that consumer is giving you lifetime value over a period of 1, 2, 3 years, as you may, look at how you measure that business. So I think that that's performance for us. Performance, but it's of course, that's the straightforward way of looking at it. Again, I jump back into funnel metrics. All of the campaigns, brand campaigns, naturally, I think, widen your funnel in general, because you really get more preference overall. So it the awareness pond, Tom, directly correlates to how your funnel widens as well, in some sense, I feel, in a brand campaign. A performance campaign also should ideally be optimized so that your funnels are working better, right? So you can get a ton of installs, but if you're not getting your installs to take rides, that means you're either getting the wrong kind of installs, you're not getting quality installs, and so on and so forth, right? So I think that is what I think Prateek had referenced earlier to measuring every part of the drop-off funnel as well, and seeing whether your campaigns are working hard enough. And that's so much for, I think, measurement as far as acquisition is concerned. With respect to re-engagement, I think that's the big game in, so in different stages of evolution, right? In a place, in a company like Ola or, company which is entrenched, right? Most people already have the app. So it's not so much about app install and transacting. It is more about getting these users to be more engaged users of yourself, right? So whatever we can do to sort of ensure that happens. So if we define a fantastic cohort, right, our best cohorts, how are we pushing more people into those cohorts? even if we haven't, we have a, say, an office going cohort, how can we get more and more people to go into that cohort? How can we get more and more rides, people to take more rides? If it's even an occasional cohort, the consumer behavior is that they may just take their own vehicles between Monday and Friday, but on Saturday, Sunday, they just don't want to drive, right? So how can you get a higher wallet share of the Friday, Saturday, Sunday customer, right? It becomes a wallet share game in some sense, right? And here you're not just competing with your relevant ride-hail competitor, you're competing with the ilks of public transport, because you also have Ola Auto, you have Ola Bike Taxi, you have all of that, right? You're competing with the ilks of public transport, you're competing with the ilks of, oh my God, I would rather take my own vehicle than wait for a cab to come equivalent. So there's all kinds of competition you're dealing with there, right? So really, how do you get wallet share of different kinds of customers, right? A weekend user will never become a weekday user because he or she's not tuned to do that. But in the weekend use case, how can you get a lion's share of his or her wallet and so on and so forth, right? I think that's where the data science marries with heuristics, like various interesting things, like, for example, what is your credit card usage, are you getting fundamentally the Google Pay customer, are you getting the credit card customer, are you getting the cash customer, you know, those kinds of things as well. So you mix, you sort of build data science, which is the analytical piece, along with the softer aspect of overlaying all of these things and trying to figure out whether you're actually moving in the right direction. I think that's sort of the slightly complex answer, but I think it's never a science.
I think the one thing that stayed consistent from both of your answers is that understand what your campaigns are expected to do upfront and then hold them true to the standard post the execution of the campaign, right? Sunil, if you have anything additional to add, which is different, or like, you know, something else that you've observed in terms of your own execution of these campaigns.
Yeah, no, I think both of them, you know, gave very, you know, on point answers. Just a couple of things that I'd want to mention. One is, you know, once you know the objective, and when you're talking about objective, I think it's also important to understand the organization view on some of these things, right? And, you know, sort of get alignment on that early on, because it's good enough, you know, as a marketer to say, I'm going to drive consideration and so on and so forth. But unless, you know, your CEO, founder, whoever, you know, also buys into that, also agrees with what it is that you're sort of doing, you're going to run into trouble. So, you know, I think that's one sort of thing to keep in mind. And there are ways of driving this. So for instance, you know, if I look at GoIBibo, I think a year, a couple of years back, there was this campaign, which was run at the time of IPL, where you could sort of, you opened up the app when the match was going on. Every time a 4 was scored or a 6 was scored, you got some points and, you know, you could then redeem that for purchases and things like that. So a lot of very interesting ways in which you can, you know, do sort of a mass campaign to drive very specific objectives, right? In this case, it was about engagement, driving engagement and, you know, driving transaction and so on and so forth. So that's one. And I think the other thing I just add is, you know, like with everything else, a lot of marketing is art, right? And, you know, I think some of these things, you've just got to also acknowledge that. And you know, that's where I think experience also comes into play, having an understanding of how you know, this sort of equation works and how it will eventually translate into numbers. It's not necessary if you're doing a brand campaign that, you know, you put a brand campaign out there and you expect to see, you know, it translate into numbers tomorrow. Much as everybody would like that, I think unfortunately it doesn't work that way sometimes.
Yeah, very true. Very true. I think we're just nearing upon the end of our time. Before we wrap up, I think the one question that, like, you know, if I was to ask, what is the one trick or thing that changed for each of you in terms of, like, you know, changing your engagement game within the app, whether that was a product feature or whether that was a marketing campaign, whether it was personalization, or whether that is all of you considering adding stories to your own app because that's the new fashion, right? So gamification, there are many things which go around the world, right? Like, so what is the one thing that has worked personally for you and like given like fantastic results, even better than what you expected? Aishwarya, if you can take a shot at this. One thing, it's supposed to be a short answer.
I'd actually wait for the rest to answer, honestly. It's as short as it can get. Can I request the others to go for it?
Sure. Aishwarya has a trick up her sleeve. We'll figure that out later. Prateek, why don't you go ahead?
I'll go ahead. So so one of the things which, again, Naveen, going back to the point of giving what users want, Because we are an app and consumers can't talk to us, there is no interface to talk. We came up with this concept of create your own package, which is passing the power back to the consumer. You want to create a bundle of different homogeneous or heterogeneous services. Please go ahead and do that. That has been a game changer when it comes to our add to cart and therefore overall conversion improvement. Be it a salon service where earlier there used to be only fixed packages that you have to choose. And then similarly for cleaning service, there were fixed packages where it's almost as if urban company is deciding for Naveen whether Naveen wants two cushions and a fan and a sofa to be cleaned up versus giving you the power to create that package. Create, edit, modify, delete. So sounds like a very simple thing, but all insights are simple, as they say, right? I mean, the most powerful consumer insights are the ones which are very, very dumb-proof and simple. So in my experience here, this feature or this ability for consumers to create their own package has been a game changer when it comes to our overall offtake as well as the entire conversion flow.
Yeah, that's brilliant, Pratik. Yeah, great insight in terms of like just a small change actually driving significant benefit. Sunil, how about you?
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole bunch of them. But let me just talk about this program that was done a while back called Go Contacts, right? So Go Contacts is a very simple idea, which is you link your contact book to the app. What's in it for you? You basically earn money every time somebody on your contact book travels, right? And that was a massive success, I think. So you basically earn $50 every time somebody traveled. And it also got you to engage because you'd obviously get a notification saying, hey, ABC has traveled and you earned $50 and you'd come in and check and take a look at it. I think that was very, very transformative.
That's amazing. I think Go Abibo, couple of initiatives that you've spoken about, now that you say, starts bringing back of like, you know, memories of the campaigns at RAN and what people were doing. Thanks for that. Aishwarya, now you have to answer this. What was your special answer?
Sure, I don't think it was a special answer. I was just trying to figure out what to sort of answer, to be very honest. But I think it was more of a proposition change that that really worked for us. I think when we looked at Outstation, usually Outstation is always about going forth and coming back, right? And even if you go only one way, you have to pay both ways because the driver has to come back. And we introduced one-way Outstation, and that was actually a game changer for us. And when we sort of did that and we put it on the app, we found that our conversion fundamentally improved, right? So Outstation really jumped in terms of the minute you knew you only had to pay a one-way fare when you came on the app. That was a big proposition change that we had sort of put on the app. It automatically, like, it's the quintessential example of a human insight playing very true in how you communicate and how it goes through the entire app funnel. And how it sort of just improves the entire funnel. So I think that was one thing that I would say. It lies between the marketing proposition and the app communication, because that's a moment of truth, right? You're deciding whether you want to take this service or something else in some sense. Yeah. So at the moment of truth, sort of telling them that, you know what, you're going to pay half the money. Ooh, interesting. You know, I will choose this over anything else kind of thing. Yeah. Right. So I think that sort of tipped the scales.
Thank you. I think... it was a very fascinating session. I'll skip the audience questions right now. I'm sure, like, you know, we'll find ways to answer it on social media or anywhere else if you try and reach out to us. On behalf of the panel, I've thrown that out to everyone. But I think overall, I think the session was brilliant because I think I at least took away is it's not just about the app experience. It's about building the marketing insight by understanding users better, understanding the people behind the Excel files and the cohorts better, and personalizing your communication. Driving programs that really drive user opt-in is what changes the game for you. And it's not about like being in the face of consumer always, right? Marketing is not just about always being present and getting their recall, but just winning their trust and knowing that a brand is available when they want it, right? I think those are some of the key things that, like, I took away at least. You know, it was a great session. Thank you, Sunil, Aishwarya, and Pratik for jumping in and joining your, sharing all of your insights. Hope you all have a great evening and the rest of the event goes well. Thanks, everyone, for listening in.
Thank you.